Those are the things that were provided to me, jail, death. But I said, you know what? I'm created to do something better.
Dark is the night. I can weather the storm. Never say die. I've been down this road before. I'll never quit. I'll never lay down.
It went from I can be somebody to I must be somebody.
So I'll never give up, never give in, never let a ray of God slip in.
The motivation for me to succeed was that I knew that there was something else that I'm supposed to be doing in this life.
Mine started at, I know I had him as a student about 1990, and it was really hard during that time. But prior to the 90s, we had not our particular school, but the neighborhood had a huge gang problem.
On an athletic field led to gunfire. One young man was shot. He's in fair condition tonight.
It wasn't to sell drugs, which I've seen. It wasn't to gangbang, which was ubiquitous. It was to do something that was going to make an impressionable, indelible impact in the lives of people.
And Lawrence was one of my top students in that I would say, okay, this is what I need from you. I need quality work. I need to see that you're keeping notes. We would have conferences. And what I liked about Lawrence is he always just had a wonderful, friendly demeanor, respectful, caring about others. You can't ignore it. He was a light in the classroom.
You know, people say education is a great equalizer. Education was my ticket into a better situation. I knew that education was going to provide me the opportunity to be better, to do better, to receive better, and to give back better. What I saw growing up, you know, dilapidated buildings, drug dealings.
We had different rival gangs coming to our one school. And again, they were the wannabes. They wanted to be like Crips and Bloods.
Gang violence. The victims include a 16-year-old girl and a 15-year-old boy.
And it was almost this presence of it's okay. It was accepted.
The community demanded that I became somebody. I didn't have a choice. There was too many people dying. There was too many uneducated people in our neighborhood. There was too much hopelessness. People didn't have hope. People couldn't get jobs.
In middle school, there were a lot of wannabes. There weren't true gang members, but there were wannabes and followers. And Lawrence was in a very big class with some of our strongest wannabes. Some of them are not with us today.
Sometimes I wonder if I didn't go to college or get help with my college finances, what would be my options? And I think about it all the time.
It's very unfortunate. Some of them, you know, you would see, like you're driving down the street and you would see painted signs of little tombstones, rest in peace, where kids were getting shot and killed.
Dead or in jail. And unfortunately, some of my friends chose the wrong options and ended up right here.
I always remember his mom being a strong person behind him, kind, and just telling me, you push him. Push him whatever you have to do.
I had a very strong mother. She would pray over us every morning before she went to work. And then she would come home late at night, and she would try to help us with our homework. And she was very, very adamant about us being educated. She illustrated to me that, you know, the resilience. If you never give up, you can do it. And
not only that, I saw a person who was diligent, again, like I said before, who wanted to do something and achieve something in life.
There's a saying that says preparation meeting opportunity equals success. I think that the things that transpired in my life over time, and also my preparing for something greater. I knew that I could do better than drinking 40s, selling dope. What separated me from others, I don't think it was much. It was a decision. It was a decision to seek more.
And so my heart went out to him at the time that he needed a place to stay, and he came to be with us. He was very respectful of my rules, and he fit right in with us.
Pastor Keith Graham, First Lady Demetrius Graham, who took me into their home. I was essentially homeless, sleeping on a friend's couch, from one friend to another friend's couch.
And he was a blessing to us as much as he thinks we were a blessing to him.
And at that time, Bryson Graham actually, his son, slept on an air mattress. He actually slept on the floor on an air mattress just so I can get a good night's sleep. I can't thank them enough for that.
Mind you, he worked all day at Olive Garden.
When I was in college, I actually worked three jobs, and I was taking 21 hours a semester, all right? So I didn't sleep much.
And he would live off not only the pay, but the tips. So that, to this day, I remember him living like that. So that's why I tip real good, because I know if there, I may be tipping another Larry.
Vividly recall, I got off of work. I was working at Olive Garden. And I had my Olive Garden uniform on, and I was praying, kneeling down, praying, woke up on the bed the next morning, getting ready, my class, it was time for my class, woke up in my Olive Garden uniform. And that's when I knew there has to be something else that can help me through college.
Larry's like, he has become like our model, that I'm looking for children who have a story of needing help, and desiring to get a place in life, just need someone to come into their life and help them out. And the foundation was able to do that with his education. And now, look at him, he has his doctorate degree. He's what we're looking for. I'm looking for children out there who have a story. And we're looking to be not the main player in their life, we're looking to be an extra who comes in, stands by their side, encourages them, and be there for them. That's what this life's all about, man. It's not about us, it's about helping others to achieve their dreams in life. And if you are another Larry, I'm looking for you. A story. Somebody not looking for a handout, but a hand up. Those are the things that were provided to me, jail, death. But I said, you know what? I'm created to do something better.